人はある日突然気づく、自分自身の可能性に。そしてそれを証明するために戦いの場へと足を踏み入れる。競い合うことに特別な形なんてない。勝つことの喜び、負けることの悔しさ、讃え合うことの尊さ、挑戦することで得られるそのすべては周りの心をも動かしていく。人はある日突然気づく、自分自身の可能性が確信に変わることに。 B レジェンド、ハースストーン。
Welcome back to the Hearthstone Asia Pacific Winter Championships. My name's Papa Smithy, and jumping over from the sidebar to the casting desk is D2. D2, how are you feeling?
Pretty good. Had a nice run from the sidebar over to here. Really excited to cast with you. We have a rivalry in this situation going on. We have Japanese versus Australia in the match and in the casters as well.
It's a bit on the nose by the producers, I think. We do have an Australian caster and a Japanese caster for our regional battle here, which is a lot of fun. Actually, Australian qualifier, Navyu, comes from the same state and the same city as me, same university as well, so fun to see that synergy.
We know who you're rooting for.
Oh, yeah, a bit one-sided.
Caster bias.
I mean, yeah. I've been lucky because, of course, I cast the Korean scene with Doa over at OGN, and we already had both Korean players make it through. Now we have an Australian compatriot, and I cast Pimping Ho last year at APAC. So
you're rooting for everyone.
That's right, exactly. I can't be biased if there's four out of eight, but we want to ask you guys who you think will win in this particular match. You've already heard who we're rooting for, at least publicly. Hashtag Mattson or hashtag Navyu on Twitter or Facebook. Use the hashtag HCT for any of your discussions, of course. We're two matches in, two matches to go, and it should be a good one.
But absolutely.
Before we get started, I'm going to introduce our Australia-New Zealand qualifier. It's Navyu.
Yeah, Navyu, a player who is one of the best players in Australia, if not the best, I would say, in that region. Really top-notch player. I mean, got in the top of the ladder in NA with his region. He's really known for that kind of deck. So really interested to see how he plays here. Looks like he's kind of calming himself down here. Maybe a bit of nerves, but we'll see what happens.
He's a young guy, only 20 years of age. What a lot of players might not know is that last year's APAC, there were two qualifiers from the ANZ region. One of them failed to get a visa, so third place Fried Chicken subbed in. If he had not been able to pick up his visa, the fourth place player was in fact Navyu, so was just one spot away from making it to APAC last year. Well, his opponent today from Japan, it's Mattson.
Mattson, a player who comes from Tokyo. He's married with a wife and two children, ages 4 and 0, and basically he is one of the most busy people. Actually, Navyu is a very busy person as well. It's like something we can, you know, kind of draw a parallel between these two players, but very busy with his job. He basically, this is a stat for you guys, he didn't sleep for 80 hours straight.
80
during the Japan preliminaries. He worked, he played day one, he worked, he played day two, won the whole thing, collapsed afterwards. When I heard that statistic, my mind was blown.
And he had quite a big misplay, I believe it was in the semifinals, playing Priest and not playing around certain combos. But it kind of puts those little misplays into perspective when we're talking about being away 80 hours just to be able to compete in that game. Crazy stuff.
Absolutely. I was able to cast some of those games. They allowed me the opportunity to cast the games for the official Play Hearthstone channel. And it was just insane because I'm looking there and he seemed so tired the entire time. And now there's actual reason for that. I mean, we actually saw one where he played ETC that he got off the Golden Monkey and was absolutely just rocking out to it. It was really fun to see.
And both these players are going to be battling against the jet lag, of course. So there still might be some elements of being tired for this tournament as well. So it's going to be an interesting one. It's two of those smaller regions, right? Japan, one of the newest competitive regions. Australia often feels like, or Australia and New Zealand often feels like an extension of the North American region just because of time zones, just because of, again, the small server coming through. So
yeah, absolutely. I mean, also the language barrier that you can have as well. And I mean, Naviyut, he's had about 10 top 100 finishes, and they're basically all on NA. So we definitely know that he's an accomplished player, but mostly on NA. Monson, on the other hand, he started out on NA, but switched over to Asia once the Japan client came out in October. And it's really like kind of moving for me to see all of the support coming from the Japanese players. You saw it in the video from before. There's the hashtag Ganbare Matsun, and so much support coming for him, which really, I mean, gives me goosebumps to see from a region that really isn't, you know, developed in esports so far.
Speaking of fan support, we're looking at the fan support, and even though you're talking about the outpouring from Japan, the ANZ crowd also seemed to be really rooting for Naviyut in this particular match. You can see the great majority of fans think that he's going to come out with the victory, and it's going to be on Matsun to prove them wrong.
I wonder if they have that hashtag on the Japanese stream.
You would say that.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like we're underrepresented here.
Fair enough. Well, it can, of course, change. We're looking at the classes, so we're seeing the bans. Matsun banned out the Druid from Na'Vi. In fact, Druid bans on both sides.
Absolutely. Druid is just a class that's so powerful here. That was actually Matsun's strategy coming into the Japan preliminaries. He said that a lot of players like to kind of have an anti-Druid lineup. We've seen a bit of that here. You know, you play the Secret Paladin, you play the Tempo Mage. But Matsun said that, you know, if you could just counter those counters and then go with a situation where you're just banning their Druid and playing anti-Druid, if that makes any sense.
Well, the countering of the counters may in fact be real as we get ready to go into our first game. It's Australia versus Japan, ANZ versus the Japanese region. Let's get into game. First match here between Naviyut and Matsun. We're going to be seeing Freeze Mage, in fact, be coming out on the Mage side against the Warrior. And seems pretty clear. Seems like it's Patron Warrior.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm actually very surprised to see this. Matsun at the Japan preliminaries went with an all-control lineup, all four of his decks, and in the finals he had to bring a fifth deck because it was best of seven. And so he brought all-control, Control Priest, Control Warrior, Murloc Paladin, basically a Reno Mage, and I'm blanking on the fifth one, but it was also control. It was basically all-control, and now he's going for a completely different strategy with this Grim Patron Warrior here.
But speaking of surprise...
Oh, wait a second.
Wait a second, is in fact...
Oh, it actually is Control Warrior. Wait, so I'm not actually surprised anymore, but we were surprised about what was it, the Unstable Ghoul that we saw?
We saw, I believe it was a Battle Rage in the starting
hand. Battle Rage.
So, who's to say, we see at least Starseeker as well, so there's actually quite a few different Warrior...
Okay, so, yeah, obviously seeing the Battle Rage, immediately we both thought, you know, it's going to be
Understandable.
The Patron Warrior. Yeah, so our mistake, but this is a deck that Kalenta was playing, although I believe he got it off someone else, though. I believe that he might have picked it off someone else. He had the Acolyte of Pains and the Battle Rage there. Basically, you want to search for that Golden Monkey as quickly as possible with the Elise.
We're looking for surprises from Dayuni in our previous series, but it seems like Matsun is the first person to really bring an off-the-wall deck to the APAC Championships. But we were talking about the surprise factor on the side of Matsun. Naviyut, this is what we expect from him. If he's bringing Mage, he is famous for his Freeze Mage. You know, a lot of players respect the Freeze Mage that he can come through with, and very clearly this is Freeze Mage from Naviyut.
Yeah, absolutely. And from Naviyut, actually, we had dinner with him one of the first nights, and he was saying to me that Monson was one of the players that he was concerned about the most, not because, you know, of... You know, everyone here is basically very talented, not for his overall skill, but because of the decks that Matsun likes to play. And you can kind of see Naviyut kind of grimacing here, not too happy with the situation, realizing that he's playing against what could be a Control Warrior, and he doesn't know quite yet.
Exactly. He's going to get the confirmation very soon. This is one of the most famous one-sided matchups in Hearthstone. If it's not the Patron Warrior, if it is some semblance of a Control Warrior, really going to struggle. Where would you put the percentage? Now, people are talking about numbers above 80%. Lopsided for the Control Warrior.
Depending on how much you actually put in the deck, as far as, you know, if you put both Shield Maidens and both Shield Blocks, I would say the number goes up as high as 95.5 in the
95.5.
Because you get into a situation where it's basically impossible. We've seen a lot of games where one of the players plays Jessica or Trueheart, and the other player just snap concedes on the spot.
Well, it's a finite amount of damage. That's what people always say about Freeze Mage. It's a finite amount of damage, and if any deck, you know, you think it'd be Priest with Heal, but no, the ability to go for those life totals above 30 for the Warrior player, as you mentioned, really makes it difficult for there to be any semblance of hope for Naviyut. And you mentioned that card, Jessica Trueheart, firmly in the hand, could potentially even be played on turn 5 with the coin that Matsun's holding on to. So those percentages probably going to translate into a win for Mattson. Is there any hope? What are you looking for? Once there's confirmation that you're against Control Warrior, is it just an inevitable run, or is there any hope? Is there any semblance
basically, of
cards you can put together if you're Navi?
You need the dream hand, right? And for Navi, it's actually not going too bad at the moment because he's able to get some, you know, direct damage and some repetitive damage in with those minions on board, which is not something you typically get to, you know, have happen for you because of those weapons in the Warrior arsenal. And it looks like we have Navi with a 27% win rate as a mage against Warriors. I mean, that's probably because he usually plays Freeze Mage. And when you're playing against six control Warriors, you're not going to do too well. Even, you know, Patron Warrior, not the greatest matchup for Freeze Mage in that situation.
And, you know, coming back to your 95-5, 27% sounds like a lot, but we have to remember that's the whole mage archetype. So even though he's played so much Freeze Mage, you know there's some semblance of Tempo Mage potentially inflate the numbers, or he's just 25% in a terrible matchup, which would reflect the skill of Navi piloting the Freeze Mage.
Absolutely. And going back to what you were asking me before about how Navi can win this game, he basically has to assemble Exodia here, right? He needs to have the Thorsten with the Antonitis and get just, you know, the Ice Lance, the Frostbolt, just all of this stuff.
You mentioned Ice Lances, both of them in hand. He does actually have that very potentially cheap combo with double Frostbolt and double Ice Lance, but again, we're hoping for something that almost seems inevitable.
Absolutely.
On the side of Mattson.
I mean, basically what you're looking for is to get, I would say, upwards of 5 fireballs off of Antonitis, whether he stays alive or maybe you just get that crazy hand that I mentioned earlier. But yeah, that's what you're looking for as Navi'd here.
So a top deck Thorsten, or looking for Thorsten.
Ooh,
wow, he actually does get Thorsten.
And you see Navi'd immediately kind of fall back in his chair, and he's thinking, do I play it here or do I get even more greedy? And you might have to get more greedy, but no, he's going to drop it right here and get the value out of it. Has really nothing else to do if he doesn't do it right now.
And now you're talking about direct damage aplenty. Roaring, the Forgotten Torch, soon to be the Roaring Torch. Double Frostbolt, double Ice Lance. This would be a historic game. You can count the number of Freeze Mage versus Control Warrior wins in competitive play on one hand,
on one finger
potentially.
Right.
Depending on what you classify as a top level competitive tournament, it would be unbelievable, but it's definitely not out of the woods just yet.
Right, and we have a tweet from That's Admirable talking about, you know, Navi really approaching this from a smart place, you know, making sure that he picks up every single cue from Mattson, picks up everything he can. And it's a sign of someone who's really kind of thought about what he needs to do here. I don't know if Navi was actually played in a live situation like this, but maybe he thought, maybe he wrote some notes down to himself saying, you know, you have to remember to do that, and that will give you extra information.
Don't believe he has, because the regionals were played online for Australia, New Zealand. Both our winners so far have been Korean players who do have extensive live experience given the OGN circuit that runs, and also the regionals were played live as well. So a factor to consider again is the degree that you're comfortable in a scenario that's very different from your bedroom or your living room or where you usually play Hearthstone.
Absolutely. And looks like, I mean, we haven't really talked about, you know, the specifics of this game so far, because we've been talking about, you know, the uphill battle that Navi'd has in the situation. But just going over things, I mean, both players are playing pretty standardly. We obviously saw that Thorsten, Navi'd made the decision to go with it. For Mattson, he's basically just waiting for a chance to get Justicar out and tank up, basically have a safe chance to do it. Because although you'd like to get Justicar out as quickly as possible, if you do so and it kind of costs you some damage because your opponent has, you know, something on the board that you need to take care of, then that can be problematic. So Mattson waiting for the right moment, and he doesn't care about damage to his opponent's face. Basically, how you win this as a control warrior is you just survive.
Out tank up, you're out armor, you survive. Tank up, of course, the name, the improved hero power from Justicar Trueheart. Looking at future turns, you can see the aggressive Alexstrasza coming through. You can see direct damage, but even though he does have the very treat ice, the four ice spells that can do a lot of direct damage, it seems like the moment he puts down Alexstrasza, there is a lot of answers even in the hand. Something like a shield block will again quickly increase the life total. So despite the optimism that was generated from specifically Thorsten coming at exactly the right time, may again amount to very little.
Navi kind of, he thought for a second about going for a really kind of next level play. What he wanted to do was, he was thinking about Frostbolting here and giving up the possibility of going with Antonitis. And the reason for that is if he freezes his opponent's face and he forces out something like, you know, like a shield slap, right? And then your opponent doesn't have something like an execute in hand to be able to kill with Alexstrasza, then maybe you can get repetitive damage that way. But unfortunately for Navi, Matsun does have many forms of removal in his hand right now.
And that's the thing about Hearthstone, is you're always acting with incomplete information. We knew that shield slam, an extra bash off the top as well to go with the shield block. The health total is already at 43. You know, we're starting to get to those points where you're going to struggle, but it's going to be that aggressive Alexstrasza, effective 15 damage to enemy face, but you can see the end result. With just a standard hero power, we're back at 30 life total. For
right, and not even the standard hero power. We have a Jessica hero power coming online right now. Navi cannot be happy about that. You can see he knows that it's going to go down, this Alexstrasza. And this is basically the beginning of the end. I mean, Naviud has a lot of damage in hand, but I don't think he has enough to get through what Matsun's going to be putting up, especially with that bash. I'm going to probably be going for this Power Blast first. Actually, how much damage do we have here?
24 damage all up with the Forgotten Torch. It's more.
Have we spoke too soon, Papa's with you?
It was 24 from what he had already had in his hand, including the Pyroblast.
Ooh, Shield Maiden. That's going to add an extra 5. Naviud can't be happy about that yet, but let's count here for Naviud, because basically this is his only chance just to burn in the face as hard as possible. With those, you know, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, that is 70, so 14, and then 17, so yeah, he's not really approaching it, fortunately.
17 would be enough to take off the armor total, but certainly not to pull off the win. I guess just buying turns while he can. Potentially getting information about what's in this deck, although he won't face it again if he is to lose to it here, so.
Right, and Matsun knows that there's no possible way for a Freeze Mage to do 34 damage. He kind of knows it's around that 20 area, so even with a Thorazine, it's not really possible. So Matsun, he's not going to commit to the bash until he really feels like he needs to.
And now you're kind of in that scenario as Naviud where you're back to 95-5. In fact, you're probably low now. You're back to, yeah. You basically have written off this game, so. What's your take on these scenarios? Because you've played at the highest competitive level, playing at BlizzCon 2 years ago. Are you the sort to concede when you're almost certain that you're going to lose? Do you just keep playing out and then use the time to think about future games? Like, what's kind of your game plan in this scenario as Naviud, where this game is certainly looking unwinnable?
It kind of depends on what type of player you are, right? Are you okay with kind of playing out this game, and you know you're not going to get down about the whole situation, then fine, you can go ahead and play it out. But people, sometimes they don't want to waste their time. They just want to get to this next match, and it's perfectly understandable either way.
Watching Naviud roll the eyes when he saw another shield maiden, that is going to be the game over. It was a heavily, heavily favored matchup for Matsun, but he does pick up the win, all in all.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was basically the nightmare situation for Naviud. But if you can find a way to take a win with this Freeze Mage, you know, further on in this match, then this match won't really matter too much. I mean, Control Warrior is a deck. I mean, I've been arguing this for a little while actually, that Control Warrior is a deck that almost never really gets swept, honestly. So as far as, you know, Naviud's concerned, this isn't really that too big of a deal in this situation, in my opinion.
And it was against both a Druid and a Warrior. Knowing that it was the Control Warrior, there was two decks that were certainly going to be pretty good against the Freeze Mage. He kind of cut his losses. Maybe that gives us information about his other decks. But the end result is an early lead to Matsun. But for now, let's get to know a little bit more about the Australian favorite, Naviud.
My name's Alex Ridley, otherwise known as Naviud. 20 years old and from Australia. Perth is it's pretty isolated compared to most of the other capital cities in Australia. So it's got a pretty laid-back lifestyle. A lot of nice beaches and stuff, a lot of nice girls as well. But yeah, you know, loving it. Australia as a region is definitely perceived as the weakest region, and for good reason. It does have like a small player base and the top end talent isn't quite there, but I feel comfortable that I can compete with these players. I take a lot of confidence out of my ladder play, and it means a lot to me to come out here and represent Australia, mainly just like for my own career really. Been grinding away at this game for quite a while, and you know, to get some sort of like tangible reward, yeah, it does mean a lot. Yeah, I'm pretty rigorous. With my sports, like outside of curricular activities, like did rowing, and then obviously football. Yeah, do that like semi-professionally. It's made me a pretty competitive person, and that definitely translates to Hearthstone. I began streaming late 2014, and it's been a pretty long grind to get partnered with Twitch. As you can tell, 2014, 2 years is like a really long time, but enjoyed it tons. My long-term goals with Hearthstone, definitely all efforts focused towards building the stream, and you know, the means to do that, events like this, like building your credibility as a player, that goes a long way to, you know, wanting to tune in and watch you. You have to kind of decide, like, you know, what are your strengths, right? Like, what type of streamer are you? Are you an educational streamer, or, you know, are you an entertainer? And I kind of went with the entertaining side of it, and you know, I'm a pretty emotional guy when I stream. Like, I definitely don't hold anything back, and you know, if I'm playing against someone I don't really like, you know, I'll say that. But I do try and fit some education in there as well. Like, I'm not taking this weekend lightly. Like, I'm, you know, I put in a lot of work to win. I'm Navi Ute, and I'm a tryhard who's going to win APAC this weekend.
So Navi Ute, one game down. You know, you were mentioning, actually, you were talking about how crazy the life is of Mattson. This is a guy who had a couple of kids at home, who has a job that he has to juggle with his Hearthstone career. Navi Ute, is at a kind of different place in his life. Only 20, still at university, but juggling life just the same, playing a lot of other sports, focusing on his studies. It's funny how two guys who, on a simple level, at very different points in their life, are brought together by the same thing, brought together by competitive Hearthstone and the will to win, which so far has proved a little bit difficult for Navi.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really, really crazy to think about, right? They both have these completely different lives. One from Australia, one from Japan. Mattson has, you know, a wife and two kids, has a really, you know, stressful job. And for Navi Ute, he's basically playing semi-professional Australian football. You know, he's, you know, working hard at university. He's doing all this stuff, and he has time for Hearthstone as well. He's been grinding. I mentioned earlier he has 10 top 100 finishes. So, I mean, he's worked his way here and, you know, managed to even get partnered on Twitch while being this busy. Pretty crazy.
Not a lot of Australian players able to get partnered on Twitch. Not even a lot of Australian players able to stream because of internet concerns there. Not something that Navi Ute brought up. But speaking of, we are in our game two. It's going to be Mattson piloting the Paladin. No information yet about the Paladin, well, but double True Silver champion has been cycled out, right, of at least a lot of secret Paladin.
Exactly.
Lists.
Double True Silver equality means it's probably going to be the Murloc Paladin.
There we go.
We see the Blue Gawar going to be that Anyfin Paladin deck, very control oriented. And this is a really fun matchup, the Freeze Mage versus the Murloc Paladin. The Murloc Paladin has that burst damage to be able to get through the ice blocks, to be able to pop the ice blocks. And they also have the healing to kind of stall when the Freeze Mage tries to turn on the heat at, you know, with Alexstrasza and start burning the opponent's face. So definitely a matchup that is winnable for both sides, but I would say that Freeze Mage has a pretty good advantage overall.
One interesting thing I observed is, of course, Amnesiac brought the Murloc Paladin 2 weeks ago back at the America's Championship. Was Reynard was talking about this matchup and said that it was 80-20 to the Murloc Paladin, so talking about it being very favored. Then we had quickly one of the other casters say that it was 80-20 to the Freeze Mage. So clearly, there's a bit of disagreement on how this matchup goes. What's your first impressions of who's the favorite, given that we now know the decks?
It's very, I mean, I've seen so many different opinions on this situation, or on this matchup, excuse me. And to hear Amnesiac say that, it kind of holds more weight than a lot of people, I would say. I've just heard so many times that the Freeze Mage is more favored. I have seen this match. I've played it a couple of times, but not enough to have a, you know, huge sample size. But I've seen it plenty of times, you know, on streams. I've seen, you know, Kalento, he queued up his Murloc Paladin and happened to run into three Freeze Mages in a row. So, and he won 2 out of 3, but he is Kalento. So, I mean, it's definitely something that's winnable. And it just goes again to what kind of draw you can get out of your decks. If you, I mean, basically the perfect draw for either player is going to shut out the other one.
Players aren't familiar. Both these decks are about really putting together certain combos, playing certain cards, and then the finishes later in the game. I guess the only thing that I really observe about the matchup is the healing on the side of Mattson often takes your whole turn. You know, the big heal spell is an 8-mana spell to be able to pick up the healing. Of course, running heal bots as well. Maybe one, maybe two, that we send the tech choices there. But given that the healing takes your whole turn, it feels like the Freeze Mage, specifically Ice Block, allows more flexibility than the healing options available for Mats.
Right. And obviously, it's difficult to get those heals out, but at the same time, usually when you're healing, you already have a board that can kind of deal with your opponent or anything that they have on the board on their side. So in that situation, I mean, it's sometimes you're able to just get out, you know, that lay on hand and still be able to control the board.
Keeping a board together against Freeze Mage also can be a struggle, given the multiple board clears available to Navi Ute. But we expect this to be a long one. We could even potentially see it going to fatigue, just because, again, certain card combinations have to be put together. Plenty of drawing on both sides. We're expecting double Solemn Vigil on the side of Mattson as well. So for now, just a small fight for the board, but it's going to be probably pretty incidental too. The big combos coming later.
One thing I want to talk about is the Shielded Mini Bot that Matsune has in this deck. That's definitely not a card that's always in the deck, and definitely could have replaced something, you know, more defensive by putting that in there. Obviously, Shielded Mini Bot can be something that's very defensive in its own right, just be, you know, to have a minion early on that can do combat damage. But Naviud, under a bit of pressure here, just going to draw some more cards. And that's the name of the game for Naviud here. As long as he's still high in health, just going to draw as many cards, get as many options as possible.
Coming into turn 5, didn't have access to any board clears. Did have the Frost Nova, but no Doomsayer to go with it. Does draw into Blizzard, so that's something for next turn. Coming back to what you were saying about Shielded Minibot, this is looking more and more like a list that I saw Kalento laddering with. I already mentioned Kalento a moment ago, of course, the European superstar. But it looked like Shielded Minibot and things like Muster for Battle were kind of subbing in for Doomsayer. This might actually be a list that doesn't run Doomsayer on the side of Matson, or maybe cuts it down to just a single Doomsayer.
Ooh, Lothab is definitely a card that could be aimed toward dealing with Freeze Mage here, and Matson, he's really thinking about this. Naviud is looking directly at his opponent, can see that Matsune's thinking about something critical here. So, first of all, when does Matsune play this Lothab? And Naviud's thinking, what card did you just draw here that's making you furrow your brow? So,
it's a tech choice as far as we can see. It's not a card we expect to see in most of the standard Murloc Paladin lists, but maybe it's just one of those heads-up cards where you feel like Freeze Mage is going to come up. We know there's 7 mages at this tournament, most of them. In fact, the great majority have been Freeze Mage from what we've seen, so always interesting to see tech decisions. Kezzan Mystic was the story in the previous series. No sign of that in the Aggro Shaman, of course, but Lothab could really be a massive card, especially when Naviud's going to be pretty comfortable that his board clears are going to be effective in the next few turns.
Yeah, absolutely. You're really not expecting to see that Lothab in this matchup. And Matsune, I mean, he went for just the Hero Power Pass there, didn't go for the Bluegill Warrior, and now Naviud is kind of perplexed. Like, what do you have in your hand that could mess me up here? What were you thinking about last turn? And why didn't you do it? So he has to kind of tread carefully here, and also he needs to be able to use his kind of board clears in a really smart way, or else, you know, he could get punished later on.
Well, you're talking about using your board clears in a smart way. The one thing about this matchup is, as Naviud, you feel like you can be greedy just because you don't respect things like a Lothab in your opponent's deck. You feel like you can be slightly less defensive when there's a big board facing you, but he is proactive. He does use the Blizzard straight away, and if he was to know there was a Lothab, it's certainly going to mitigate a lot of damage.
Absolutely. And Matsune picks up a Zombie Child, which is one of the worst cards to see at this moment. Maybe, you know, outside of some unusable spell like Humility, perhaps. But yeah, definitely Matsune doesn't want to see that right here. I mean, Zombie Child can be okay in kind of pinging off armor, but outside of that, it's not the greatest. And really, you're kind of putting negative pressure on your opponent at that point, right? Because they can heal up from it.
Well, if Lothab's a card that he's desperately looking for this matchup, as you mentioned, Zombie Chow certainly looking for the more aggro matchups where the Murloc Paladin might be rolled over in the early game. But speaking of that Lothab, it comes down, and that's kind of the confirmation for Naviud, because you look at this hand, certainly not a lot of playable options at 7 mana.
Right, we might even see just an Ice Lance on the Lothab. If we see the Acolyte of Pain come out, then Matsune could maybe make Naviud overdraw. So Matsune actually played it in a really interesting turn, right on turn 7, and all the key, you know, impact cards in the Freeze Mage arsenal, like Frost Nova, like the Secrets, are, you know, come at that 8 mana spot with the Lothab kind of making the spells more expensive. But yeah, so interesting timing for Matsune there. He's actually going to commit to the lay on hands here. So Matsune is going to turn on the Jets and try to end this game as quickly as possible, not going to try to heal up, and this is very risky on his side.
There's Cycle and there's using lay on hands on your Murloc War Leader, but that's all he needed to achieve with this turn, is drawing further into his deck.
Honestly, I think that could have been a critical mistake, because looking at what Naviud has in his hand, he has a lot of tools available to him, and knowing that, you know, a lay on hands has already been used. I mean, there might not even be healing in the hand of Matsune. We see, other than True Silver, that's, you know, he doesn't have anything right now. And even if he did, there's only basically 2 left. These days, you only run 1 anti-kill bot, and you don't really run, I mean, you run the 2 lay on hands, but not 2 anti-kill bots, because it can be problematic in certain matchups.
Worth noting that to fit in Lothab, something had to be cut as well. So outside chance that the 5 mana heal bot was also cut. We don't have confirmation of that just yet, but it's going to be limited heals, and even though he's at 30 health, the mechanics of Alexstrasza and just how Freeze Mage operates, you can see Consecration needs to be used. There's not a lot of reach from the Murloc Paladin list outside of the Anything Can Happen, but Alexstrasza slammed down. A lot happening suddenly, right in the final turns.
Yeah, absolutely. Naviut has a clear plan now. I mean, you can see him. He was worried before about what Matsune could possibly have, but honestly, it really goes down to that play, Matsune going for that lay on hands. I think Naviut was really happy to see that, and now he's kind of on the fast track toward victory, I would say.
He's got the second Ice Block in hand, so as you mentioned, he's got a minimum of two turns, even though very clearly the Ice Block will be popped this turn.
Right.
Turn lethal looking almost inevitable, as you mentioned.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's no healing. Basically, Naviut says, you know, you used your lay on hands. Do you really have another heal in your hand right now, or were you just going to, just being, you know, super aggressive there? And, you know, Naviut, maybe, you know, we can see both hands. We're kind of seeing this as a win for Naviut, but maybe Naviut's not so comfortable in this position. Maybe he's a little bit worried about, you know, some sort of healing coming out. But when he sees there's none, he's going to be pretty happy, I would say.
I mean, the struggle for Naviut is that when you see the first lay on hands used just so lackadaisically, almost just using it purely for cycle, getting no value, even though you're against Freeze Mage, you kind of have to think in your head there's a second one in hand. Is there any other way you can really process what looked like a fairly greedy use of the lay on hands that now, very clearly, should come back to punish him?
Well, here it comes. I mean, the Frostbolt's going to lock out that True Silver Swing, which means that Monster needs to draw healing right now or he is dead. No more Lothip to be used. And there's a lay on hands! Oh my goodness, right? I mean, you just immediately go for that, right? I guess you could check for to see if his Ice Barrier... check for Ice Barrier to see if you maybe concentrate there. So decent play by Matsune. He picks up that Lay on Hands, and Naviut is not happy to see that at all. Only has that Power Blast in hand to his name. And yeah, all of a sudden, just that one card has possibly turned this game around.
It's a huge draw, there's no other way to put it. Desperately needed. Doesn't have a way to freeze
and,
face. So.
Yeah, he needs to freeze face and the board, and that is it! Matsune takes the game with a very aggressive stance and is rewarded by that Lay on Hands off the top there. I mean, if you think about it, if he didn't go for the lay on hands that turn, then he wouldn't have drawn the second Lay on Hands.
It's true, he got further into his deck with what looked immediately like a fairly greedy Lay on Hands, but Cycle was the name of the game, at least from his perspective on that turn. Lothep was the tech card, the boredom and extra turns. You just think about the way that he got so deep in his deck, both Lothep and drawing more cards with the Lay on Hands eventually pulled it off, even though it looked very much like it was going to be a Freeze Mage victory.
Yeah, I was definitely skeptical of that play, I have to be honest. But if you think about it, I mean, if he hadn't gone for that, maybe, you know, Naviut has a bit better draw. Maybe he gets better in, or further into his deck. Maybe he has a ton of bursts that can go through all three heals. So maybe Matsune thought that was the only chance he needed the one heal to be able to heal him out of that damage. And if he gave Naviut too much time, maybe he's dead in the long run.
I mean, we return to what he had in his hand. I'm sure maybe this will be something that we'll see on the sidebar, but he had double Equality and a Zombie Chow in his hand. So his hand quality was very low, so it incentivized Cycle, but we didn't know it would go like that. That was about the most exciting end to that game. It swung in this matchup. Freeze Mage versus Murloc Paladin. I don't expect it to swing in the final couple of turns, but it was a true swing and a very one-sided victory in the end.
I mean, there are definitely key cards on both sides, like that Lay of Hands, like those heals, and on the side of the Freeze Mage, just, you know, that stall or maybe the burn that they can have to finish out the game. So definitely is possible, you know, those huge swing turns. As we see, coming into Game 3, we have the Warlock from Matsune against Naviut's Freeze Mage once more. And Matsune actually played a Demon, Handlock, Sand, Mountain Giants at the Japan Preliminaries, so we'll see what kind of deck he has brought here. It looks very Reno Lock-esque, but it could still be that. I mean, he basically had one Shadow Flame, one Hellfire, just to make sure that he had his early game locked down.
It's worth noting that this might actually be our first 3-0 sweep of the APAC Winter Championships. Both other games, we saw a victory going to one of the competitors, but Naviut sticking with the Freeze Mage. Of course, if he is to lose the Series 3-0, there'll be no information about his other decks, which would be a major thing.
That's Twilight Guardian. So this is almost certainly Malygos lock here from Matsune. So pretty interesting to see that Zombie Chow kind of tells it even further that it's probably going to be the case. So we'll see how quickly Naviut can catch on to that fact.
See some fans already hoping for the reverse sweep. Ironically, Naviut, during the course of the ANZ qualifiers, he had two games where he took a 2-0 lead, ended up 2-2 and winning at 3-2, so almost got reverse sweep twice, and then in the grand final, pulled off a reverse sweep. So he needs to channel whatever he had that was able to pull that off to do that once again here, because he's certainly looking facing down triple match point.
Absolutely. He was able to do that against his friend Flamingo Bums. Let's see if he can pull off that magic once more here. Definitely is an uphill battle, and this goes back to what we were talking about earlier. Navi wasn't happy with this matchup against Matsun in particular because Matsun likes to play these decks that basically kind of counter Freeze Mage.
So the Malilock, let's talk about that deck, because it's another one of those things that kind of been the recurring story of the Winter Championships is what's old is new again. We saw the return of mid-range Paladin. We saw the return of aggressive Paladin, Zoo Paladin almost to some degree. And now we're seeing Malilock, a deck that felt like it had been supplanted by so many other popular Warlock archetypes. What's your take on the Malilock versus Freeze Mage matchup?
Well, we also saw Face Hunter. I really wanted to point that out. Face Hunter is something we cannot leave out of this broadcast. But Matsun, actually, he was mentioning on Twitter, he didn't give away what deck he was going with, but in Japanese on his Twitter, obviously, he was talking about the differences between, you know, Reno Lock and Malilock and what he should bring. And basically, the conclusion he came to is that because Malilock has a better matchup against Reno Lock, which he expected a lot at this tournament, that's why he went with it in the end, in my opinion. Basically, he was saying, you know, Malilock seemed to be doing so well against Reno Lock, so maybe, that's what he was saying on Twitter at least, so that's probably the conclusion he came up with at the end.
No way for Navi to know yet that it is the Malilock. Could very much be Reno Lock from the perspective of Navi. When you see the Zombie Chow in turn one, you're ruling out Zoo, so. Apart from that, he's certainly leaving his options open.
Right, and this is a very interesting play from Navi. He goes for the Doomsayer, but I mean, even though he already has the Frostnova in hand, he goes for the Doomsayer, and why that's important is because there are very many ways in the Reno Log to be able to deal with a Doomsayer, right? There's an Owl. If the Warlock is able to tap enough, they can pick up that Owl. They can also pick up Siphon Soul, which is, I mean, at 6 mana, it seems like a lot, but when your opponent uses 5 mana to set up that combo, you know, you can definitely get that out.
It wasn't relevant for the previous one, but as you mentioned, the 5 mana combo is the Frostnova Doomsayer. So you don't feel as secure trying to go for that board clear on turn 5 as you do in most matchups if you're the Freeze Mage.
Absolutely. And we'll see what Matsun goes with here. I mean, you could go for a number of things, actually. You could go for the Blackwing Corruptor. You could go for one of these Drakes. The Twilight Drake is the bigger Drake. And it basically, I mean, this is interesting because Navi now can get some face damage and some repetitive damage with his minions. So, you know, you see Navi immediately go for that play. He definitely wants to get that face damage in so he can finish off his opponent quicker. And if it is a Malilock, if it is a Reno Lock, then he wants to basically scare his opponent into using healing while he's at the low 20s.
And the other amusing thing is that Twilight Drake is a card that cycles in and out of Reno Warlock decks. So still no 100% confirmation that it is going to be at minimum a Dragon Warlock, if not the Malilock. Of course, no confirmation yet of the Malagos, but heavily suspected given that it just makes so much sense in terms of the synergies with Blackwing Corruptor and Blackwing Technician.
Absolutely. One thing, though, with playing the Twilight Drake last turn was that before he picked up the Azure Drake, there was no way to activate the Twilight Guardian from his hand, speaking of Matsun. So okay, he goes for the Azure Drake, and Naviut is going to look at this, and you see him mouth something. Did you catch that?
He said what? I believe.
Okay, so he's definitely concerned that he might have misjudged what this deck actually is, and now is finally starting to figure out that it is indeed Malilock.
There's no ambiguity that there's a Malagos somewhere when you see Soulfire being played out of the hand that wasn't drawn from a Dark Peddler. He is running a single Soulfire.
It was the Mortal Coil.
Mortal Coil, my apologies.
Right. So he saw the Mortal Coil, which is actually played in Reno Lock. There's a one of, but typically Azure Drake is not something that you see in Reno Lock.
Or Soulfire being played out of the hand rather than just being generated by Dark Peddler. So we expect there to be a Malagos somewhere. Navi has once again come to the realization that things aren't all they appear. The Lothar and Murloc Paladin was a curveball, and this bringing of a very unique deck, one that saw a lot of play months ago but hasn't seen so much play. I mean, if I was to pose a question to you of what Warlock deck is someone bringing, where would Malagos Warlock fall, given there's so many popular Warlock archetypes?
Well, it depends on what you consider an archetype, right? Are we talking about, you know, one Zoo deck with Doom Guards, one Zoo deck with Sea Giants? I mean, if we're talking about just Zoo and just, you know, Reno Lock, then I would say third after those two, but definitely there's a lot of archetypes within those that make it interesting. So Matsun is basically fearless here. He's not concerned about the repetitive damage from Naviut's minions on board. Sounds strange to say it, right? You're worried about the 1-1s, but I mean, he's just saying, as long as I get aggressive here, then Naviut's going to have to deal with my board, and he's going to have to use those minions to trade with mine.
And the reason why you bring it up is that, you know, we mentioned it in the previous series about the finite damage from a Freeze Mage deck. We're talking about direct damage from spells, so when you're getting in repetitive 2-3 damage a turn, those calculations change just because the damage required is lower. But, yep. Fearlessly pushing to face, and now Naviut sitting at 7 mana. He has to find a way to deal with this board, but Blizzard certainly will only stall out. It won't be able to remove anything that's already put together.
And there's a lot of calculations going on in the head of both players here. Monsoon saying that I have one heal, but that might be enough if we get into some sort of race, right? If Naviut suddenly starts, you know, pointing, you know, burst spells to my face, maybe I can just heal bot out of range and pop the block and really put a lot of pressure on my opponent. That's probably what he's thinking right now. And, you know, just trying to play the long game might not be too beneficial for me because of all the options in the Freeze Mage arsenal, you know, in this current meta. And another thing is to consider is that one of the biggest ways, I mean, obviously the Malilog doesn't have Reno in the deck, but the way in which it really burst heals is by going with Bran and Healbot, which is an absolutely huge number.
And I want to point something out. Emperor Thorison is going to last another turn. Blizzard was committed to, but no clearing of that card, something that has already been a massive swing card at this tournament. Leaving alive Emperor Thorison is not something you want to do against any hand size, but against what's basically a full hand from
And Matson. Picks up the Malagos too. That's going to be discounted as well.
Oh boy.
Naviut saying that my only chance of winning this game is if I go as aggressive as possible, and I can't be worrying about the discount from the Thorison. He's saying that, Matsun, if you played that Thorison, then you probably have the pieces in hand anyway, and I'm not going to be able to deal with it. So, you know, take all the discounts you want, because I'm just going to go aggressive.
Well, speaking of aggression, Blackwing Corruptor to the face. Doing some quick math.
Wow.
It's going to be 17 damage with just Dark Bomb, Soulfire, and Malagos, all of which are playable on turn 8. Because of that Thorison lasting an extra turn.
Absolutely, but Monsoon's taking some damage as well. Let's see what he decides to go with here. Finally, that Thorison goes down. From Naviut, doesn't actually have that much burst damage. He only has, let's see, 10 damage. I mean, a little bit more if he adds the Blood Mage Thalnos, but not too much to his name right here. Maybe he's thinking that he needs to pick up something in the future, especially with that Acolyte of Pain. But for the moment, Naviut doesn't have the win in his hand.
No way to pop the block this turn for Matson, but 17 damage burst for 8 mana is already insanity. That's the reality of the cost reductions that come through for Emperor Thorison. So pushing 17 damage this turn doesn't seem necessary, especially because you will be discarding something with the Soulfire. So going to find an alternative line of play for this turn.
Right, and Matsun had 10 cards in hand, so he had to play a card first before he went for, you know, the Light Warden onto the board. Let's see if he goes for the Twilight Guardian plus the Healbot just to get some more power here. One scary thing is if he doesn't clear the board, then... Oh, he's actually just going to go for that Big Game Hunter, interestingly enough.
Just using it as a 4-2 minion, just a tempo Big Game Hunter pushed on the board.
This is extremely risky from Matsun, though. I mean, Naviut has been basically pushing damage to the face the entire time. It's very easy for Freeze Mage to do 16 damage from with 9 mana. So just Matsun playing the risk game here, saying, you know what, I'm just going to go as greedy as possible here and play the Healbot at the last moment. Maybe waiting for that Bran Bronzebeard.
We're talking about calculations. And obviously, this game is all about theoretical damage and outputs. What you respect from your opponent. Is it a consideration for Matsun that we haven't seen Emperor Thorison used from Naviut? So actually being able to put out 16 damage in a turn is that much more construed? That there's less combos of cards that will put it out just because there's no cost reduction.
Right. I mean, you are kind of limited to having Frostballs and Ice Lances in
sure.
that situation in order to be able to pull that off. And now he has picked up a second Ice Lance. So Naviut does have the damage, I believe, or am I miscalculating this? He does have 14 damage in hand with that Blood Mage Thalnos. So if Matsun doesn't play a Healbot here, he is going to die.
Big turn then. So far, Matsun's line has been super, super aggressive, but there doesn't seem to be any reason not to play. If he starts with Azir Drake, Healbot's still playable. It is 3 mana, but talking about 6 creatures on the board. And cycle and still play that Healbot. We're still waiting to see the Healbot's going to be played.
Yeah, he's going to play the Healbot here. That's going to get him out of range of what Naviut has at the moment. By the way, we saw Naviut play the Forgotten Torch last time. There's a Fireball. Is that enough? He's not going for it right away, so I believe it's not enough because he's probably... Unless he's just recounting it.
Waiting to see the calculations. I spy at least 17 damage this turn. Frostbolt, double Ice Lance by itself is 11 damage.
Well, he has 2-turn lethal, that is for sure, because of that Pyro Blast in hand. Does he have it right here? Caster Math is too difficult. We're just going to let him go for it. And that is actually exact lethal. And that's coming out for Naviut. So Naviut is going to finally take a game here. Perfect mana, perfect damage, and it's going to be 2-1. No sweeps here.
That was a super exciting game. Both these players playing on the knife edge. We saw Emperor Thoris and Stick for a second turn. Naviut, let's come back to what you were talking about. That little chip damage, that 2 damage a turn he pulled off for multiple turns did actually come and be massive right at the end.
Yeah, absolutely. And Mazdan, again, going for the very aggressive play, going for, you know, basically just ignoring the minions on board, letting that chip damage come in, and it worked for him. I mean, basically, it wasn't the same exact play that he made in game 2, but he went for a very aggressive play in turn 2, worked out for him then, didn't work out for him this time, unfortunately.
Both players taking a crazy aggressive line, and in the end, Naviut finding a way back into the series. We talked about reverse sweeps, pulled one off in the finals, looking for one here in his first game. Won't be eliminated if he is to lose, would have to fight through the loser bracket. So, Freeze Mage finally off the chopping block here for Naviut. Has access to Warlock and Warrior. These are the same 4 classes that he ran at the ANZ qualifier. So far the Freeze Mage has been the same, but it'll be interesting to see if we see any different archetypes or if he just sticks with what worked in the ANZ Championships.
Right, absolutely. He said he was very confident in the decks that he brought. Unfortunately, like he said again, his decks aren't the greatest against what Matsun has brought typically, but we'll see how they fare here now that he's finally gotten the Freeze Mage off his back.
Well, the fans certainly haven't changed their line whatsoever. They're still heavily cheering on Naviut. It's going to be the late night there in Australia, but people are clearly staying up to watch their favorite come through. Matsun's still in a great position, though, to take through the series.
Yeah, absolutely. Depends on what these, you know, these deck archetypes here are for Naviut, absolutely. And, you know, Naviut definitely has a chance to come back here. I mean, we've seen a lot of fan support in the tweets. Definitely, you know, tweet at us, tweet hashtag HCT, make sure your voice is heard. I want to have our Japanese fans as well. Come on, guys. I mean, you're obviously rooting for Naviut to get back in the series. Really awesome to see all the support for both players here. But we are going to game in game 4.
It's going to be Matsun sticking with, of course, the Malagos Warlock, and it's going to be Control Warrior versus Malagos Warlock, at least what we can see from the Mulligans.
Absolutely, and this is a deck that Naviut did bring to the Australia-New Zealand qualifiers, or the preliminaries, excuse me. We'll see how this plays out. One of the issues with playing Malagos Warlock in this situation is that sometimes you don't have enough burst damage to get through the massive amounts of armor that Control Warrior can have. And, you know, you're basically relying on that, you know, that repetitive minion damage.
And let's return to the matchup we saw earlier. We saw Control Warrior versus Freeze Mage. You put that at a 95% advantage for the Control Warrior. I feel like this matchup, certainly it's not that high. It's not 95%, but it's still a deck that often the finisher is Burst from Hand. 17 famously with Malagos, Dark Bomb, and a Soulfire in the same turn. There is a lot more board presence. You're still running all the different dragons and the cards that interact with dragons. But as you mentioned, there is some semblance of finite damage, at least in finishes. Where do you put the Malagos Warlock versus Control Warrior
this
matchup?
It's very difficult because I have not seen this matchup in a long time. And one thing that's very, you know, important to consider is that the Control Warrior has changed quite a bit.
It's fair to say.
I mean, it's gone to more of a removal style. It has the Elise in there. And, you know, I think that's going to be much harder for this particular, for this Malagos Lock to be able to deal with, you know, this removal warrior. There's just so much more armor to be gained here. And by the way, I do like the play by Matsun to play out the Zombie Tower. Even though it makes this Twilight Drake a bit smaller, it makes it less likely that Naviut has the ability to kill it with something like Shield Slam.
It's fun how the Control Warrior archetypes of today with Elise actually are a bit more Freeze Mage in that they run very few minions themselves. You know, they're not running as many threats. Grommash, you can see in the hand already, some people play a Dr. Boom, some people cut the Dr. Boom. It's usually just going to be the six mana minions like Justicar, Trueheart, Shield Maiden, and then everything else is going to be removal focused. So,
absolutely.
A lot's changed, but we still get the same matchup from months ago.
Well, we see Naviut kind of going for a bit of a greedy play here. Could have, you know, set up some, you know, a kill on one of these minions with the, you know, the bash and the shield slam, but wants to save some of his removal options here. Is able to pick off that Blackwing Corruptor. But yeah, Naviut, I mean, he picks up the Justicar. That's pretty good for him. He's, you know, can maybe tank up out of range of certain things. But, you know, basically he's been getting beat down by Matsun thus far.
Well, waiting to see if the list for the Malagos Warlock is similar to previous ones. We mentioned that Warriors changed a lot, specifically Control Warrior. Are we going to respect an abusive Sergeant? Because we've already had confirmation that double Big Game Hunter is being run by Matsun.
Right.
A big game hunter will get a lot of value from the Abuser Sergeant. You'd be able to kill off something like the Shield Maiden or the Justicar True Heart, but leave that for a future reference.
Yeah, definitely. Something to keep in mind. And we do see the Dr. Boom actually from Naviute there. And let's see if he plays it out. Would be a pretty greedy play. I mean, it would be kind of a heads-up play as well because of the fact that, you know, Matsune isn't close to having any sort of lethal damage here, but he does have double soul fire, so... Wait, how much damage is this?
6, this is... 10, 14, 17?
It looks like... the Dark Bomb as well. Is that lethal damage? A caster Wrath,
I believe you have to use both soul fires, though.
Right. So that, so basically he has a 7-8 chance to get the victory here. Oh no, he just has it with the Hellfire. With the Hellfire.
Out of nowhere.
That is just going to be it. Monsoon has the victory, does the math, doesn't even need to take a chance with the Soulfire there. Gets rid of the Malagos saying, I don't need you anymore. And that's going to be 3-1 over to Matsune.
And Matsune actually running the double Soulfire, something that was cut so early for consistency, doesn't even need to use it. Man, we're talking about finite damages, but because he put himself in that position where he was killing off the minions, he was taking a lot of chip damage early from those minions, that game almost kind of ended out of nowhere.
And a very consistent theme from Matsune, going very aggressive, even though he's playing basically all control decks, realizing that, you know, Naviute's going for the same exact thing. We see the bracket there, Matsune moves on. Unfortunately for Naviute, a player that I respect greatly, a very good player, he's going to be moving down to the lower bracket to face the loser of Sugi and Ping Ping Ho. Definitely not a place you want to be.
And Group B, there's so many good players, Sugi and Ping Ping Ho, two of the tournament favorites. One of those guys is going to drop through to the lower bracket. But for now, we're going to pass it over to Frodan, who's going to be standing fireside with our winner from that game. It's Matsune.
Appreciate that, Papa Smithy and D2. I'm joined by the winner of the previous match. It's Matsune from Japan, who's traveled all the way here to America. That match was pretty intense. Naviute's one of the best Western players. Did you feel nervous at all during that match?
Very strong player, so he was very nervous about it.
Awesome. Well, I wanted to ask how your travel is to America. It's the first time I heard you're in this country. What do you like about it so far, coming all the way from Japan?
It takes like more than 10 hours, and it was so long.
All right, well, I guess so far he's trying to adjust the best he can to play his matches, but he's doing a good job. I want to ask about your shirt. It seems like you're wearing a shirt that was drawn on. Does it have any special significance at all?
T シャツが非常に特殊な絵が描いてあるように見えるんですけど、何かスペシャルな意味あるんでしょうか?
My daughter draw this panel. Give me a big hug.
So his daughter drew this art for him, so he won today for his daughter, and this is his esports power.
Oh, that's really sweet. His daughter drew that, and now he won it for her. Well, congratulations. I hope this is just the beginning of your journey. You have to play tomorrow as well. Good luck in that. Ganbare. In the meantime, we're going to head over to the sidebar where TJ and Kibler are standing by to talk about Matsune's match and what it means in the upcoming victory. So let's head over there.
Thank you very much, Dan. And I'm standing next to someone who I want to draw on my shirt to give me esports power. It's Brian Kibler. And that was an exciting match, Kibler. And I know you were excited about it even more so than most people because we got to get to see Malagos Warlock. So what are your thoughts on this deck right now? We haven't seen it in quite a while.
Well, it has a lot of dragons, and that inherently makes it awesome. But Malagos Warlock is a deck that is very effective against other Warlock decks, other combo-style decks like Reno, because it can burst for so much damage out of nowhere. And we saw exactly that happen in the Warrior game.
Yeah, indeed. And I'm looking forward to seeing that deck and how it performs across, you know, more matchups than just one, because classically it's done pretty decently against Control Warrior, so we only have a small sample size. But moving back to a little bit earlier in that game, game number two, it was the Murloc Paladin matchup. And there was an interesting play there that, you know, I saw some people saying, oh, that seems a little bit weird. It seems a little bit greedy. So we can go ahead and bring up the clip from this matchup. And Kibler, why don't you walk me through this? It's basically just Matsune using Leon Hands on his Murloc War Leader.
Yeah, I mean, here we see Matsune make a pretty unusual line of play. He chooses to play Lay on Hands just to heal his War Leader. But the key thing here is that he draws three cards. And a lot of players would expect in a matchup against Freeze Mage that you'd want to hold your healing until late in the game.
Yeah.
But a key thing here is that Matsune had a really weak hand in general and was trying to dig to find more cards that he could use to actually pressure it for that game. He likely has a significant amount of additional healing in his deck, which he ends up finding later on.
Yeah, and we could tell that from the get-go of this matchup, and it seems to be sort of a playstyle from Matsune, where he plays really aggressively in these control matchups. It's not often that you see a Murloc Paladin, you know, pressured this much, and we saw him use, you know, the True Silver Champions to chip away damage, Consecrate on an empty board to chip away damage. Do you think that's the way you have to play this Murloc Paladin versus Freeze Mage matchup, is sort of board-centric and aggressive like this?
The onus is on you to win the game. The Freeze Mage has the tools to end the game very quickly and the tools to survive as well. If you give them a lot of time to set up their ice blocks, to put together their burn, they're ultimately going to be able to blow you up at no matter how much healing you have.
Yeah. All right. Well, that was a great match, and I'm looking forward to seeing more of Matsune's decks because it seems like really interesting stuff.
Oh, they're really cool.
They are really cool, yeah. And before we move on, I want to talk to you about Murloc Paladin in general. Murloc Paladin, if you look back to all these players playing in, you know, the tournaments that they qualified for to get here or their preliminaries, because APEC had a little bit of a different structure, a lot of them did play Murloc Paladin. So talk to me a little bit about this deck and why we're seeing so much of it now.
Murloc Paladin is a deck that thrives, much like the Malygos Warlock, in a more controlling metagame. When you're playing games that are going to go very long against decks like Control Warrior, which we saw Matsune bring as well, Murloc Paladin has this sort of inevitable end game of anything can happen that can really close things out.
All right, well, thank you very much, Brian Kibler, for joining me at the sidebar. We do have one match left remaining on the day. It is going to be between Suggy and Pin Ping Ho, but before we jump into that match, let's take a look at some highlights from Matsune versus Naviyu. We'll be right back.